Ready?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Dear God, we just thank you right now for your goodness, God. We thank you for your mercy, Lord. We just thank you for being our God on today. God, we thank you. We thank you for just loving us, God. We thank you for everything you went through for us, God. Yeah. We thank you for this 21 days of John, God. We thank you for how it enlightened us and let us see your heart for us as your people. And your desire for us to live right and to follow you. So God, we honor you right now. We honor you right now, God, for being awesome, for being a provider, a way maker. God, we just love you on this day. We honor you. We ask that you come into this lesson on tonight, God, and that you send increase and you provide what is needed. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen, amen, amen.
Amen. Girl, you look like you ready.
Oh my God. These last 7 days of John have just been awesome. It has been just simply awesome. God is amazing. He's good.
Yes, he's really good. So good. So does anybody, Peyton, do you want to share anything about what you have read and what the Book of John has meant to you? I see you. Come on, go ahead and unmute yourself.
One day last week, I listened to it audibly.
Yeah.
And it really does give you, like I said, a different perspective. Yes. But it was just mind blowing. It's like, you know, when Jesus says that I'm at the throne now, you know, it's like, I mean, it's just the revelation of I can walk through the door and I can walk straight up to God and Jesus and just talk straight to them, just like I'm talking to you all. Yes. When before, you know, I didn't have that privilege. That's mind blowing to me.
Yeah.
That's absolutely mind blowing. And just the way when Jesus talked to his disciples and he was trying to explain things in a very simple way, how patient and compassionate he was.
Yeah.
Because Lord knows, I think I would have snapped. Some of that stuff.
Yeah.
It was shared in such a simple way, but I just love that Jesus is so compassionate and patient and that with us. It's helping me because I'm in a, and it's so appropriate that I'm learning this right now because I'm in that place where I really need this word. These chapters are very relevant to me. So I thank God for the choice that you all made for us to go into this because it's really speaking to me.
Yeah. Awesome.
Awesome.
That's great.
That's great. Well,
thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
So, Ms. Shay, do you want to share anything?
No, not yet.
Okay. All right. Okay. And Valerie, it's so good to have you back with us. I know you've been working.
Yes.
Welcome. So does anybody else have anything like they'd like to share before we get started?
Oh, keep Cynthia in prayer. Her daughter has surgery today.
Okay.
Keep Sister Margaret's family in prayer too.
Okay.
So her son-in-law is in the hospital. He had emergency surgery last night. So keep him in prayer too.
Okay. Well, let's lift them up now, both of them.
Okay.
Father, we just thank you so much right now that we can come to you in prayer because of the blood of Jesus.
And
that
Jesus,
I'm going to mute everybody here, guys. There we go. But we just thank you that you will give us the answer to everything that we've asked of you according to your will. And we lift up Cynthia's daughter right now before you. We thank you that you are healing her body from the top of her head to the soles of her feet, Father, that every day that she will just recover miraculously and that it will be an easy transition back to health. And we just praise you for it in the name of Jesus. And we lift up Minister Margaret and her family, Lord God. And we just thank you that your perfect will is being done in every situation. Anything that is not in accordance with your will for the abundant life that you have designed for us. You said that that we would be saved in our entire household. So we thank you that salvation includes everything, spirit, soul, and body salvation. And we just thank you for it now in the name of Jesus for Sister Margaret's family. And we just praise you for the, we're looking forward to hearing the praise reports. And we just praise you for it every day this week as these people come to our mind, Father. Just help us, prick us by the Spirit to remind us, just to lift them up, just to show our gratitude for you for your answer. And we praise you for it in the name of Jesus. Amen. So Kim, I'll meet you again. There you go, darling. So I don't know what's happening today. I'm going to mute you back. We're getting some feedback. So what I'll do is when I finish speaking, I'll turn myself off and turn you back on so we don't have that noise, hopefully. So we're going to go, I'm going to share my screen, and we'll just go back over, especially for the benefit of the people who are new to this evening. We want to go over, sounds like my studios is on again, the studio speaker, so I've turned that off. All right. So the Gospel of the Book of John really gives us reasons to believe in Jesus. And the testimonies that I keep hearing from everybody, even myself, I'm reading them. And it's just amazing that I've read the Book of John. I've read verses out of the Book of John for decades now. And for us to be spending this time and focusing on it the way we are, it's amazing how much I am learning and relearning about Jesus. And this book of all the Gospels talks the most about who he is. And the others, we hear more about the kingdom, but in this one, we hear about who Christ is and why we should believe in him. And so we started this series because we wanted to help you establish a daily habit of Bible reading. So even if you're just coming into it and you haven't been with us since the beginning, I want to challenge you just to go back and read one chapter of John every day. There are 21. So that's why we chose 21 days of John and 21 days we know it takes to establish a new habit. So we want to also help you develop a personal playlist. So you can subscribe to an email list where every day we will send you an email about that each chapter. And then it will also include a song that's kind of a part of the theme. And we'll go through the ones for this week tonight. We like to let you hear a little bit of it. And if you were logged in before we started at 7, we were playing that playlist. And then we want you to go ahead and receive those emails in your inbox. Hold on. There we go. Samantha's here. Hi, Samantha. And then each week we've been getting together. This is our third week. We're getting together to review the 7 days that are coming up. So even though this is going to be our last Godstalkers meeting for 2018, I can't believe I'm saying that already. You will continue reading until you get done with your 21 days. And then we want to be able to discuss your insights. So I love, thank you, Peyton, for sharing with us what you've been getting out of it. And others have been telling me about it. There's some people who have other classes and things they have to do on Tuesday nights. And so I've been hearing from them throughout the week. So that's been pretty exciting to get everybody's input. And then we just really want to be accountable to each other to read the entire Book of John in 21 days. And so we're on our way to doing that. Some people are ahead of us. They said they were already into like 17 and 18. So some of us will go ahead and get started early. So I am going to mute myself and unmute Kim. So she...
Hi, everyone. I am just so excited about this particular last week of these scriptures in reference to the last 7 days of the 21 chapters in John. It's just awesome. Well, today I am starting with day 15. You have been chosen. You have been chosen. It says, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. John 15:16, and that's the New International Version. I am just so overwhelmed with this particular scripture, this particular verse. And, you know, let me read the King James Version. The King James Version says, "Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give you." Wow. That right there, it speaks volumes. He chose you. He chose you. Wow. As I began to read this particular scripture, the question came, are you chosen? See, that right there speaks volumes. Are you chosen? That's only a question that you can ask. That's between you and God. Are you chosen? So let me give you a little history on this particular verse and chapter. It says, this is when Jesus, listen very closely. Oh, this is so good. Jesus is addressing the disciples before his death, right? Right before he knew he was getting ready to be crucified, he was addressing the disciples. But listen to this. This was after Judas had left to go betray him. Because remember last week we talked about whatever you do, do quickly, you know. So now he's talking to the true disciples. My God, my God. He's talking to the true disciples. So now this was after Judas. Now Judas is on his way to do what he's going to do to betray Jesus, right? Get that, get them pieces of silver. So now Jesus is talking to the true disciples. He said, "I have chosen you." So now, are you chosen? That's my first question to you. Then, as I begin to look at it, I was like, what is chosen? What is chosen? Having been selected as the best or the most appropriate, handpicked, anointed, appointed, elected, or favored. That is what chosen means. So now you're handpicked because you're chosen. Because it could have chose anybody, but I chose you. So you're appointed, you're elected, you're favored, right? Okay, so now. Okay. What are you chosen to do? So now we're just not chosen to sit around, right? We're just not chosen not to do anything. What are you chosen to do? So now he says that you may do what? Go forth, bring forth fruit that would remain. So now, if you look at 1 Peter 2:9, it says, let's talk about why we're chosen. But you are a chosen race. You are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness unto the marvelous light. Oh my goodness. So now you are not just chosen to sit around and do nothing. You're not just chosen to act any old way, because right now it says you're God's own possession. So you're chosen by God to be used by God for whatever it is he needs you to do, to proclaim his word, to proclaim this gospel, to walk into the marvelous light, to help people see the light. So you're chosen, you're handpicked, you're favored, you're appointed, you're ordained to do what? To proclaim the gospel, to reflect God on the earth. Those are the reasons that we are chosen. Some of the reasons that we are chosen. So as I begin to look at this, it just began to really just touch me. It says, it explains in detail. So why are we chosen? If you're saying you're chosen, you need to be reflecting some of these things right here. If you're saying that you are chosen, you know, that you are chosen to walk this walk, to live this life, then now you got to start, you should be doing some of these things. Because why? You're God's own possession. Why? Because he chose you. Oh my God, he chose you to do it. Your pastor didn't choose you. The husband, your mother, your best friend didn't choose you. Now I don't need you reflecting them. I need you doing what God has chose you to do. Because now when he chose you, he clearly tells you in his word right here why he chose you. So now, if you go and you take, as I still begin to study, it was getting so interesting and it was getting so good in reference to being chosen, right? It says, Ephesians 1 and 4, the King James Version says this. It says, just as he chose us in him, oh my God, before the foundation of the world, that we will be holy and blameless before him in love. Can I say that again? Just as he chose us in him, before the foundation of the world, that we will be holy and blameless before him in love. You know, saying this love thing, it plays such a great part in our walk with Christ. It plays such a great part that Jesus, once again, because you know, last week we got into this love thing, but once again, he brought up love, that he chose us before the foundation of the world. He said that we'll be blameless before him in what? In love. So as chosen vessels in our walk, as God's own possession, because that's what the word says, as peculiar people, you know, that's what the King James Version says, love plays an important part. So now, as a chosen vessel, there are certain things we got to do. I'm going to go over it again really quick. We got to know that we're God's own possession. We're not ourselves. We don't own us. We are God's. He chose us as his own. So that means now I got to walk in his will, walk in his way, not in my desires and not in my will for my life. Not in nobody else's agenda for my life. I have to know God has chosen me. See, that's the most important thing. Are you chosen? Do you know that you're chosen? Do you know what it means to be chosen? And do you know after you're chosen, what are you supposed to do? So saints, you have been chosen by the Most High. And with that comes responsibility. You have been chosen.
I love that. Love that. Oh, so let's go to day 16. Ask for anything. In John 16:23 from the New King James Version, it says, and in that day, you will ask me nothing. Most assuredly, I say to you, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give you. And so that day that he's talking about is the day when he's no longer walking in the earth with the disciples as he was at that time. So he's saying, now that I'm gone, now you've got an opportunity. And I love what Peyton was saying. She can walk right up. We can walk right up to the Father and with the Son sitting right next to him, right? We can walk right up to him and ask him for anything. He says, whatever you ask in the Father in my name, he's going to give it to you. Because he said, if I don't leave, your friend won't come. And that was in verses 4-7. I'm going to read that. John 16, verses 4-7. I didn't tell you this earlier because I was with you every day. But now I am on my way to the one who sent me. Not one of you has asked, where are you going? Instead, the longer I've talked, the sadder you've become. So let me say it again, this truth. It's better for you that I leave. If I don't leave, the friend won't come. But if I go, I'll send him to you. And then verses 12-15, he talks about the fact that the Holy Spirit is that friend that he's talking about, right? And he says, he's going to take you by the hand and guide you into truth. Isn't this something? So we love, like, you know, like you've got a parent or somebody that you really, somebody who's taken care of you, another relative maybe that raised you. You know, it's natural for us to be attached to those people. We want them to stay we want to stay in the same relationship with them that we had, you know, from childhood, because we're comfortable with that. And so the disciples had been walking with him, and they'd gotten to the point where they were comfortable with him. I mean, they acted crazy, you know, from time to time. Sometimes they act like they didn't even know who they were walking with. They forgot, like, that he was the Son of God. They forgot words, prophecies that he gave them, promises that he gave them. You know, they were human just like us. But at the same time, the more they walked with him, the more they loved him, the more they wanted to be with him, and then the more accustomed they got to him being there. And it was amazing. It had to be amazing to be walking with Jesus to see all the things that he would do. The Bible only recorded some of them, but to be able to be with him day in and day out to see everything that he was doing, how he was taking care of people, how he was raising the dead, how he was restoring limbs, how he was giving back eyeballs, like all the miraculous amazing things that he was doing, right?
I said giving back eyeballs.
Girl, remember when they said he reached down, got some mud and spit on it, got some dirt and spit on it, and then put it in that blind man's eyes? So it had to be phenomenal to see that. But Jesus is saying, look, I'm not going to be with you all the way, always. They're going to tear down this body, and I'm going to raise it back up. They're going to tear down this temple, and I'm going to raise it up. I'm going to die, but don't worry, I'm coming back. Like he was instructing them all along, but he's telling them, look, I got to go, because if I don't leave, just like you got to leave your parents, just like you have to leave that grandmother, you have to leave that person that took care of you so much in order for you to kind of spread your wings and grow, right? So you can fly, right? You got to be thrown out of the nest. So Jesus is saying, look, I am leaving, because if I don't leave, I'm not going to be able to send the Holy Spirit to you. But if I go, I will send him, and he is going to take you by the hand and guide you into truth. So you, like when Kim was talking about, why are you chosen? We're chosen so we can proclaim, right? We're chosen so we can find our 12, right? We're chosen. So he's saying the Holy Spirit's going to take you by the hand, and he's going to show you how to do that. So the very thing that you were chosen to do, I'm going to send a friend who's going to help you to make sure you know how to do that. He says, I still have many things to tell you, but you can't handle them now. But when the friend comes, the Spirit of truth, he will take you by the hand and guide you into all the truth there is. He won't draw attention to himself, but will make sense out of what is about to happen. And indeed, out of all that I have done and said, he will honor me. He will take from me and deliver it to you. Everything the Father has is also mine. That is why I've said he takes from me and delivers to you. And it's beautiful, this divine distribution system. So the Father gives it, he imparts everything to the Son. The Son listens to and follows the Father's instructions. Then the Son sends us the Holy Spirit, who then takes us by the hand and teaches us and helps us to understand everything that comes from the Father through the Son, right? Yes. So we can figure out how to walk it out and how to be chosen in the earth. Whew, that's so good.
Yes.
that's good to us, okay? And so then in verses 8 through 11, I love he was talking about refusing to believe is the basic sin, right?
Wow.
When he comes, when the friend comes, when the Holy Spirit comes, he'll expose the error of the godless world's view of sin, righteousness, and judgment. He'll show them that their refusal to believe in me is their basic sin. Did you catch that? So it's not fornication, adultery, it's not greed, it's none of those things. The world is condemned because they don't believe in the Son. They don't believe in who Christ is. That is the basic sin, right? And then he goes on and he says, he'll show them that their refusal to believe in me is their basic sin, that righteousness comes from above where I am with the Father. And I love that because, you know, in the Old Testament law, which Jesus came to abolish, right? He came to fulfill it. Right. In the Old Testament law, the whole purpose of it was to show us that we could not be good by ourselves, that righteousness was not something that we could live up to. we absolutely just cannot. There's nothing in our flesh that makes it possible for us to do right and be good. Nothing. We need the blood of Jesus. We need his forgiveness. We need his covering. We need his final sacrifice for our sin. No longer do the priests have to go in and bring the blood of animals and goats so that they can cover our sin, right? To atone for it, because they couldn't remove it. The Bible says that the blood of animals and bulls and goats could not remove sin, but it says that Christ is the final sacrifice. He's that perfect lamb that was slain before the foundation of the earth was laid. And so our righteousness comes because we believe in him. It's not something that we do, but the Holy Spirit gives us the power to be witnesses and to live this Christian life and be chosen and examples and to proclaim the message of who Christ is, to let other people know, hey, you don't have to be bound by sin either. So the things that we see, we do in the flesh, those are just outward manifestations of the fact that we don't believe in Christ. And to the extent that we are still sinning over and over and over and over, that just means our minds have not been renewed and we have not accepted and truly believed in the full work of Christ. And then we're not allowing the Holy Spirit to do his job. Whew. Righteousness comes from above. And then judgment takes place as the ruler of this godless world is brought to trial and convicted. So judgment was not reserved for us. Judgment was reserved for Satan. And so God does not want us to partake in judgment. He wants us to receive who Christ truly is and allow ourselves to become made right because we believe. And that is it. So we can ask him for anything because of that. And then in verses 23 and 24, he says, when I leave, ask the Father for whatever is in keeping with the things that I have revealed to you. So everything, he's telling these disciples, look, you've been walking with me. You've been listening to me teach. You've been seeing the works that I do. You know what the scriptures say. And I am really just fulfilling everything that they say right in front of you. And because you have seen this, and this has been revealed to you as the truth, when I leave, you can ask the Father anything that lines up with who I have shown you that I am and what the Word says, right? Everything that I've revealed to you, you can ask according to that. Verses 23 and 24 in the message, it says, this is what I want you to do. Ask the Father for whatever is in keeping with the things I revealed to you. Ask in my name, according to my will, and he'll most certainly give it to you. Your joy will be a river overflowing its banks. And verses 25 through 28, Jesus doesn't have to make requests on your behalf anymore. This is, again, what Peyton was alluding to. So verse 25, I've used figures of speech in telling you these things. Soon I'll drop the figures and tell you about the Father in plain language. Then you can make your request directly to him in relation to this life I've revealed to you. And I was telling Peyton this weekend, oftentimes like Hebrews 10 talks about coming boldly to the throne of grace. And that so many times I've imagined, and it also talks about how Jesus is praying for us. And I've imagined him standing in front of the Father with holding his blood and reminding him and saying, look, he's praying for us with his blood in front of the Father, telling him, reminding him of what he did for us, reminding him of the sacrifice that he made for us. And he's praying on our behalf. And so this has been the image I've had in my head for years. And then when I read this, I was like, Jesus is sitting down at the right hand of the Father, and we, because of what he did, have the opportunity to just walk right up to the Father all by ourselves and ask him whatever we want. Is that not amazing? We can go directly to him. It says you can make your request directly to him in relation to this life I've revealed to you. I won't continue making requests of the Father on your behalf. I won't need to, because you've gone out on a limb, committed yourselves to love and trust in me, believing I came directly from the Father. The Father loves you directly. First, Isn't that something? First, I left the Father and arrived in the world. Now I leave the world and travel to the Father. Whew. That's so good.
You never heard it viewed that way.
Never. I probably have read, I can't even tell you how many times I probably read these verses, but it just blew me away when I finally saw it again this way. I mean, it very plainly, he says, I won't have to make any requests on your behalf, because now you can do that directly yourself. And I love it that, I love this song by BB and CC, because he talks about, you don't even have to be afraid about what you're asking, because basically she says, it's like walking up to daddy as he sits in his big chair in the living room. Come on now, come on, Peyton. That's it. When you go to big daddy in his chair and you ask him and he's gonna give it to you. And so BB and CC talk about the fact that, look, he can handle it. That's good, he can handle it.
Yes, and sometimes we just need to be reminded.
Hello, yeah, we do.
Like Peyton said, we can just walk up to Big Daddy in the chair.
We can ask, yes, we can.
Oh, day 17, it says, get to know God. Get to know God. So this New King James Version, John 17:3 says, and this is eternal life, that they may know you. Ooh, come. The only true God and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. So now the history of this is Jesus was, you know, talking to his Father. So Jesus was talking to his Father and he began to say, this is eternal life. What? This is eternal life. Knowing God, truly knowing him, knowing the Son, Jesus Christ, this is eternal life. So as I begin to study this particular chapter and this particular verse and the word, some of the different things just came to mind. So I basically wanted to know, and I think I kind of broke it down, what is eternal life? What is eternal life? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. John 3:16, and that's the New American Standard. You know, he simply said eternal life was what? Knowing, truly knowing him. Mm-hmm. Truly knowing him. Truly knowing God. Truly knowing him. That is so important. Truly knowing him, truly knowing Jesus Christ. Truly knowing him. That's what it's about. There are benefits of eternal life. What are the benefits of eternal life? Because if eternal life is to the fact of us having a relationship with God and truly knowing who God is, right? That means not only what we normally think when we hear eternal life is, oh, when we go to heaven, but eternal life is knowing God right here, my God, right here on this earth, right here on earth, we experience knowing God. We experience the benefits of this true eternal life. We experience it not just when we die. We are experiencing it right now. Because why? He said, truly knowing who I am, truly knowing God, truly knowing Jesus, right? So this kind of tells us that the dynamics of our walk comes with benefits, because we now have power because we know, truly know God. We now have authority that comes with this eternal life because why? We truly know God. See, we constantly think, oh, all this good stuff, all these things are gonna come when we die. But there are some benefits right here and right now on this earth from us simply, as he said in the scripture, what is eternal life? He said, truly knowing God, truly knowing the Son. That is it. So now we benefit right now Because why? We truly know him. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, who believes in should not perish, but have eternal life. So now we don't just have to, it's not just perishing right now. It's not just so much of everything we're going into in this world taking us out or defeating us, you know, or we never having victory. No, we live through Jesus Christ. We live through relationship with him. We live because he is our God. We live this eternal life in him because we know him. It's so important that we catch it, because his word simply says, this is eternal life. Truly knowing God, truly knowing Jesus Christ, not wondering, Do I really know him? Not wondering if I have a relationship. Not wondering, can I really live this life? No, his words made it so simple. And I never even looked at it. I just constantly looked at eternal life as, okay, when I'm dying, when I die and I have, you know, eternal life when I go to heaven. But the Lord says in this particular scripture, he clearly says, this is eternal life. Truly knowing God, truly knowing Jesus Christ the Son. This is what this eternal life walk is about. Do we truly, truly know him? What are the benefits of eternal life right here on this earth, right here? Knowing who God is, that is what it's about. Get to know God. Get to know God. It's clearly not saying get to know God when you're dead. Right. It clearly tells me that eternal life is knowing him. So if I'm dead, you know, it tells me right there, there's some eternal life right here. And what's the eternal life? Knowing Jesus Christ, knowing the Son. So this thing is so deep, and it goes beyond just the grave. It goes beyond just us dying and going to heaven. He clearly tells us right here on earth, it is to know him. Gwen said in the very beginning, when she talked about, you know, God and talking about when it came to her part, and she was talking about God, and she was talking about in reference to who he is, and us basically getting back to what I said also, knowing who that we're chosen and knowing who he's our father, he's our daddy, and there's benefits and we can go to him. Why? Because that, once again, is knowing who he is. The scripture simply said, saints, this is eternal life, knowing the true God and his son, Jesus Christ. Get to know God, get to know him.
Shay said, that is really good. There are so many promises we don't take or accept from God because of viewing eternal life as something in the hereafter when we go up yonder.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. So, so much more than that.
It
so
is.
So much more than that. And our song that goes along with day 17 is a worship song from Pastor Joanne. All my heart.
Quiet place with you, I bow before your throne. I bear the deepest part of me to you and you alone. I keep no secrets, for there is no thought you have not known. I bring my best and all the rest to you and lay them down. With all my heart, I want to love you, Lord, and live my life each day to know.
To get to that part each day to know you more, and it's something, as I was listening to that, it just kind of just brought back um or brought to me my mind visions of just an intimate, close relationship. Like, he wants to have that with each of us, that that is available to each of us, that God is not some being off in the universe somewhere, but that he's close. He belongs to us, and he wants to have a relationship with us. And that's so beautiful that God, that Jesus made that possible, right? We can just walk up, and I like what Peyton said about Big Daddy in the chair. You know, my sister has two children, and I remember her youngest daughter, she's now 15, so she can't do it anymore. But when she was a little tiny thing, it used to crack me up how she would make my father into a slide, a human slide. Like, literally, she'd make Granddaddy stretch his legs out, put them together, stretch his legs out, and he's sitting on the couch, and she would climb up on him and literally slide down his body, down his legs, like he was a slide. And so that reminds me, Jesus wants just to be the closest, God, I mean, the Father wants to be the closest with us, and that we're so comfortable with him that we can go and ask him anything. And he said, if we do it, if we ask according to what Jesus has taught us and then as according to his will, that he would do it. Isn't that beautiful? So day 18 says, love the truth. I came to bring truth to the world. And all who love the truth are my followers. John 18:37 from the Living Bible. All who love the truth. So are you seeing a theme? All of those who know God, those who accept who I am, those who love the truth more than a lie. And in verses 2 through 4, he was betrayed by Judas. Judas, his betrayer, knew the place because Jesus and his disciples went there often. So Judas led the way to the garden, and the Roman soldiers and police sent by the high priests and Pharisees followed. I'm trying to just kind of outline like the major events going on in each of these chapters. And I just found it so interesting. It says they arrived there with lanterns and torches and swords. Jesus, knowing by now everything that was coming down on him, went out and met them. He said, "Who are you after?" They answered, "Jesus the Nazarene." He said, "That's me." Right? He goes, "That's me." So he was ready and willfully ready to go, especially after he'd come out of the garden. He had just made a decision and given himself to the fact that this is what's going to happen, and I'm going to allow it to happen. And when they came looking, he wasn't running and hiding. He was like, "Who are you looking for?" "Okay, that's me." Right? Then he was arrested by the Roman soldiers and the Jewish police. You know, this time of year, we hear a lot about this story in the Bible. In my Bible Gateway app, I noticed they always bring up the story of the birth of Jesus. And at some point, we see all these scriptures around this time of the year, this story. But it was interesting to me. He was betrayed by Judas. He was bent on doing what he did. And then the Jewish leaders had to take him to the Romans to try to get them to kill him because they didn't have the legal authority to do it. So verses 12 through 14, he was arrested by the Roman soldiers and the Jewish police. Then the Roman soldiers under their commander, joined by the Jewish police, seized Jesus and tied him up. They took him first to Annas, father-in-law of Caiaphas. Caiaphas was the chief priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had advised the Jews that it was to their advantage that one man die for the people. And so he was interrogated by the chief priest, Annas. So then they took him. That's verse 19 through 21. Annas interrogated Jesus regarding his disciples and his teaching. Jesus answered, "I've spoken only in public. I've taught regularly in meeting places and the temple where the Jews all come together. Everything has been out in the open. I've said nothing in secret. So why are you treating me like a conspirator? Question those who have been listening to me. They know well what I have said. My teachings have all been above board." So, you know, of course, they couldn't come up with anything, but they were taking him from place to place trying to find something. He had told Peter, "You're going to deny me three times." And he did that in verse 17, in verse 25, and in verse 27. So when they seized Jesus, took him and started interrogating him, Peter was there. And then the people around him were like, "Wait, weren't you with him? And he kept saying, nope, I don't know him at all. And don't be laughing at Peter, because you know we be doing that stuff. We do that in other ways. We may not, it may not come out of our mouths, but we deny him by our actions.
That's a good one.
So then verse 24, we do, and he's an example. Like, and it was interesting watching, reading these chapters and looking over and over again the responses of the religious people, looking at the reactions of the disciples as they went, you know, to and fro with him. And it really, I started having more compassion for all of them, because I started realizing, wait, they are examples of how we're acting. And so God wants us to look at their behavior and measure ourselves against that and say, wait, am I behaving that way? And for us to make the adjustments so that we are like the people that receiving with gladness and believe, instead of like the disciples and the religious people that were constantly questioning him and doubting him. And so then in verse 24, he was interrogated by Caiaphas. I'm going to go on. And then he was led to Pilate. And this was interesting. Verse 28, 29, they led Jesus through then from Caiaphas to the Roman governor's palace. Listen, they are doing everything they can to find a reason to crucify him. It was early morning. They themselves didn't enter the palace because they didn't want to be disqualified from eating the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and spoke, what charge do you bring against this man? He knew they didn't have one, but he had to. He asked for Jesus. He said in verse 37, so are you a king or not? And Jesus answered, you tell me. Because I am king, I was born and entered the world so that I could witness to the truth. Everyone who cares for truth, who has any feeling for the truth, recognizes my voice. So he's telling us, this is how you know if the people that are my disciples are by the ones that love the truth. And what got me was that through all this interrogation, all this stuff, he knew he was about to be betrayed. He knew that he was going to the cross. He knew that he was going to have to die. And all along, he's just saying, look, I told you the truth. And if you love the truth, then you're my disciple. And this song by Kristen Gray, this brother, if you've never heard of him, you need to look him up on whatever you stream music. Let's just listen to his lyrics are amazing. His music is beautiful. It's called Follow You. What I love about that is if we're going to follow him, we got to love the truth. We got to stay close to him, stay on his heels. And the only way we can do that is if we love the truth.
So day 19. Before we start, does anyone have anything they want to say or that they want to add? Because remember, this is interactive.
That's right.
Just Gwen and I. So is there anybody that want to say something other than in the chat? Gwen can unmute you before we go into day 19. Anybody? Okay. Just wanted to give you that opportunity if there was something that you needed to say. It is finished. Day 19. So this is the 19th chapter of John. And of course, this is talking about, we're talking about Jesus' death, right? So we're getting to the point where now, you know, Jesus was, you know, towards the end of his life. And at this point, he was thirsty. So if you read the previous verses before that, because it's talking about his death, which most of us know. So it talked about how, you know, he became thirsty and he asked, you know, basically he says, I'm thirsty. So they gave him vinegar to drink instead of water, you know. And the King James Version says this. So when Jesus had received the vinegar, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head and he gave up the ghost. All right. So once again, it's talking about Jesus dying on the cross. He asked for something to drink. They gave him vinegar. Here it says sour wine. Then he said, it is finished. He bowed his head. He gave up the spirit. He gave up the ghost, meaning Jesus died. He died. So once again, it was just overwhelming reading about what God did for us, how he did it for us, when he did it for us, what he went through for us, how he just simply, he died for us. That's what he did. So as I began to write and to study this, and I began to fill out and put down questions, I kind of wanted to know, basically, as I began to study this particular chapter, talking about it is finished, and you know that he completed his task, and I looked at finished, and it says, having completed or ended an action or activity. Having completed it or ended an action or activity. So then I began to go on and just begin to think about vinegar. You know, thinking about here he is, he done, you know, was on the cross, done nailed to the cross, he was beaten, all these things, and he's thirsty. And they give him vinegar to drink. And vinegar, you know, we all know what it is, but I began to look it up in the dictionary. It is a sour tasting liquid containing acetic acid. So in other words, you know, it's something that if you just drink straight, you know, it is going to mess with your throat. It's going to mess with your stomach. You know, it could cause ulcers. It's so many things that vinegar could do to harm your your insides. And all that he went through, and when he became thirsty, that is what he was given to drink. But you know what? He did it for you, and he did it for me. He completed, he finished what he had to do. So I looked up thirst, and it says a feeling or a need to want to drink something. A feeling or a need to want to drink something. So you know what? I like I said, and Gwen said it before, we read these scriptures so throughout our lives. We've read these things, you know, and growing up in church and Sunday school, Bible school, we have read this stuff over and over. But what amazed me as I began to look at it, you know, the scripture prior said he thirsted, right? So, and then I noticed that, oh my God, all this stuff happened before he completed what God, oh my God, he completed what he was chosen to do. Let's go back to that chosen. Because remember, you know, we talked about being chosen in the beginning for this walk and knowing that you're chosen. Because see, the thing about knowing that you're chosen is that that's going to help you finish. That's going to help you not give up. That's going to help you not walk away from this Christian walk. Knowing that you're chosen is going to help you complete the activity or the action that God has put before you as a chosen vessel. Knowing. So now I begin to look at it and I'm like, wow, God, you thirst before you completed what you needed done. And it's so amazing because what he needed, what he was chosen to do was something great. What he was chosen to do was so great that it saved mankind, right? So it was important that he finished that. It was important that he finished it regardless of the vinegar, regardless of his thirst, but it was amazing that he began, the closer he got to completing what he needed, he thirsted, right? The closer he got to it, he began to thirst. So I begin to look at that. And it says, you know, I begin to think about it. I said, Lord, sometimes, you know, we hear people say, I'm thirsty for God. You know, I'm thirsty for Jesus. You know, oh, you know, you get closer to God, you got to thirst for him. You know, you really want to be close to God. You know, you want to walk in the calling that he has for your life, that he has chosen you for. You have to thirst after God, right? You need to be thirsty. You know, I laugh because Pastor Joanne says that a lot. But we hear people say, you have to thirst after God. But what was so amazing to me was before he got to where he needed to be and all the things that was going on at the end, he thirsted before that victory. He was thirsty. So I begin to look at it in the natural and in the spirit. And it says, Psalm 63:1 says, "Oh God, you are my God. Early will I seek thee. My soul thirsts for thee. My flesh longeth for thee in a dry and thirsty land where no water is." Psalms 107:9 says, "For he satisfies the thirsty and filled the hungry with good things." And filled the hungry with good things. So as I begin to just study this, and I, like I said, I never looked at it like this before. But before Jesus completed what he needed to do, he thirsted. He thirsted. So sometimes when we trying to get close to God, trying to get to know who he is and who he has called us to be and understanding our purpose and in what way have we been chosen to proclaim the gospel and what way have we been chosen to be his own and what it is that we have to do, you know, before we can sometimes get there, we find ourselves now we're thirsting after him. We're seeking him. We need to know what it is that he has for our lives. So in part of that scripture, I looked at it and I said, "Oh my God, you thirst." But he was so close to victory. He was so close to the end of what he was chosen to do. So sometimes in this walk with God, we got to get thirsty. We got to get thirsty to know him, thirsty to be like him, thirsty to love like him, thirsty to understand why he has chosen us for what he has called us to do. Why? Because in the midst of being thirsty, we get to understand God a little more. In the midst of being thirsty, we get to understand why we're here. All that he went through, being beat on the cross, you know, nailed to the cross for us, he didn't get down. He didn't get off that cross. He finished that task. He said, "It is finished." He didn't quit. He held on in there. Why? For us. He did that for us. So blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Matthew 5:6, the King James Version. So there's something about thirsting. It is more than just the fact that, oh, you know, Jesus was on the cross. He could have said a lot of things. But when I begin to look at it a little deeper in the spirit, saints, in this walk with God, for us to fully understand what it is and not to give up and to complete this task, we have to thirst for him. We have to. For those who hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. He finished his task. He didn't give up, and he went on to do something great. So in this walk with God, we want to be like him. We want to act like him. We want to talk like him. We need to understand we got to finish some things. We need to understand we can't quit in this walk. We can't quit through, even through the sour vinegar, we can't quit. Because now, let's take it in another way. We may not have to deal with vinegar, but Lord knows there's some things come our way. It's some things that come our way that make us want to say, no, I'm not going to deal with that. You know, oh, no, I'm not going to still lay on this cross and get a nail in my hand. I'm not. There's some things that come our way. But if Jesus finished it, we can finish it. If Jesus finished it, we can finish it. And that is what we got to keep in mind. He stayed on that cross. He did not give up on what he was chosen to do, because we're chosen. So don't give up.
What I love about that, Kim, is the world gave him vinegar, right? But yeah. It says that in a dry and thirsty land, his flesh is longing for God. So in this age that we live in, we're going to experience those dry times, right? Yeah. The land itself will be dry and thirsty.
Yes.
And so even if you get the sour, you get the bitter, he's like, "If you thirst for me, then I'm gonna satisfy you with righteousness. I'm gonna take care of you."
Right. Yes.
We can be confident that when we step into the thing that we believe God has chosen us to do and be, when we read the word, about what we're supposed to do and how we're supposed to behave as his chosen, we can be confident that even if in this world it produces that bitterness, if it feels dry, if we experience the drought, and it doesn't matter, because this is the example of the fact that we are going to be filled. We're going to be satisfied. Isn't that fabulous?
Yes. And you know what, Gwen, that goes back to the having the eternal life with God right now. In our spirit, it's because we know him.
Yes.
You know how you hear some people say, some people who are sick, sick unto death. So they lay in the bed and they can't move and they can't do anything. But they said, I have my spirit lives. My spirit lives, because that's the eternal life. Why? Because I know this man. I know the true God. Yes. So I have life. Yes. Even though this body it can't produce what it used to do, my life is in Jesus. That's the eternal life, because I know the true God.
Yes. Come on. Wes Morgan did. I love this. You paid it all. I don't know that I've ever watched that whole video. I'm going to have to go back to that. So day 20, you are blessed because you believe. Because you believe, you're blessed. You're not blessed because you're good. You're not blessed because you go to church. You're not blessed because you don't cuss. You're blessed because you believe. John 20, 29 from the New King James says, Jesus said to him, Thomas, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. So after Jesus died, because you remember, he told them over and over, he said, I'm gonna leave, but then I'm coming back. And when I come back, you're gonna be happy. You'll be sad when I leave, but you're gonna be happy when I come back. Right? He told them over and over again. And I'm getting myself there. In verse 20, 1-2, it says, early in the morning on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone was moved away from the entrance. She ran at once to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, breathlessly panting. They took the master from the tomb. We don't know where they have put him. And then verses 13 and 14, Jesus appears to Mary Magdalene outside the tomb. They took my master, she said. So she's talking to him, doesn't even realize who he is. And I don't know where they put him. After she said this, she turned away and saw Jesus standing there, but she didn't recognize him. And then in verses 19 and 20, Jesus appears to the disciples. Remember, he said, I'm going to go away and you're going to be sad, but then when I come back, you're going to be happy. So he's coming back. And it's so funny. I was telling Peyton too, when we were talking about this at church yesterday or Sunday, how he was continually telling them what was going to happen. And they were hearing him, but not really hearing him. And, you know, to their credit, they had never experienced this before, so they really didn't have a point of reference. But it was just always interesting how he was constantly telling them ahead of time, this is what's going to happen. And now, verse 19 and 20, it says, later on that day, the disciples had gathered together, but fearful of the Jews, had locked all the doors in the house. Because now that he's gone, they're like, uh-oh, everything's about to, you know, come down on us, because we were walking with him. But Jesus entered, stood among them, and said, peace to you. Then he showed them his hands and his side. And then verse 22, receive the Holy Spirit. Jesus breathed into them. So remember, he said, I've got to leave, because if I don't leave, your friend won't come. And now he's died and been resurrected, and now he's appearing to them after he's died, right? But now I had never seen this before. Breathe into them the Holy Spirit himself. Verse 22 says, then he took a deep breath and breathed into them. Receive the Holy Spirit, he said. If you forgive someone's sins, they're gone for good. If you don't forgive sins, what are you going to do with them? I love that. If you don't forgive sins, what are you going to do with them? But I love that he told them, receive the Holy Spirit, and that he breathed into them himself. And then verses 24 through 25, Thomas doubted. He said, I'm not going to believe it until I see the nails, the holes in that were, you know, from the nails, and if I touch those holes and put and in his hands and in his side, I'm not going to believe until. So verse 24 and 25, but Thomas, sometimes called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples told him, hey, we saw the master. But he said, unless I see the nail holes in his hands, put my finger in the nail holes and stick my hand in his side, I won't believe it. I won't. And then verse 26, 8 days later, his disciples were again in the room. This time, Thomas was with them. Jesus came through the locked doors, stood among them, and said, peace to you. And then in John 20, 29, he says, so you believe because you've seen with your own eyes. Even better blessings are in store for those who believe without seeing. Right? We got to believe because, or we are blessed, he says, because we believe, right? Even right. Better blessings are in store for those who believe without seeing. Okay? And it's part of our nature, right? You don't want to get too excited about something. Like, have you ever wanted something from God and even prayed for it, but then you were kind of scared to actually believe that it was going to happen because you didn't want to be disappointed? That's, we're trying to believe when we see. And that's why he's saying you're blessed because you believe without seeing. Right. Because, and so we have eternal life because we know the one and only true God. We have a relationship with the Father because we believe in his Son. We can walk right up to the throne of grace and ask Big Daddy for whatever we want according to the will of Christ because we believe. So that is the source of our blessing. The basic sin of humanity is that they don't believe. So when we believe, and even there were many times when the Pharisees would challenge Jesus about something that he'd said because they'd reference Abraham. And Jesus said, if you were sons of Abraham, then you would believe like Abraham. Bible says that Abraham, now this is in the Old Testament before Christ had died, before he'd come even to the earth, it said that Abraham was counted as righteous because he believed. So we see in the Old and the New Testament that believing is the source of blessing. And that is it. It's not our actions. It's not what we do. But now we behave a certain way because we believe. Right? Right? And I love it. Peyton said they were hearing him, but they were not listening.
That's right.
Yes. And Valerie, yes, the playlist is in the email. Each day the song is in the actual email. And then if you go to the website, godstalkers.club, and click on worship, you'll see all of the worship playlists that are all together as well. And I love this from Hillsong, This I Believe. That's so good.
Day 21.
Woo!
Do you love me?
Wait, I'm over here. Push your buttons.
The Living Bible says, after breakfast, Jesus said to Simon, Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Then Jesus told him, follow me. Follow me. That's John, the 21st chapter, and that's in the Living Bible. I want to give the history of this particular chapter. This was after Jesus had rose from the dead. And this was the third time that Jesus had showed himself to the disciples, you know, after being risen from the dead. So this was the third time. This was when they were by the sea. So he said, do you love me? And it was so amazing in the word, when you read this particular chapter, it says that he asked this of Simon Peter, but as you begin to read the different verses in this chapter, it said, the disciple that Jesus loved. The disciple that Jesus loved. That same Peter who denied him three times.
That one.
That same Peter that Gwen was talking about.
Yes.
Oh, you know, I think it was chapter 18 when that denied him, you know, three times. But this, the word of God says in the 21st chapter, it says, the disciple that Jesus loved. And you know, that thing hit my spirit and it did something for me because, you know, a lot of times we do certain things and in life something may have happened and, you know, we didn't do what we were supposed to do as far as Jesus Christ was concerned. And people want to make you think that he can never forgive you or he can never love you. But he loved Peter and he loves us. So no matter what it is that we've done or what we're going through, know that you are loved by God. I just felt so compelled to share that. Jesus loved Peter. It said the disciple that Jesus loved. So know that. Do you love me? Was what he asked him. Do you love me? He said also, follow me. He also said to him, feed my sheep. Mm. Do you love me? Can you follow me and feed my sheep? So, you know, as I begin to look at this particular scripture and what was so amazing to me, because we know, you know, we done did the 21 chapters in John, so we kind of know a little something here, right? We kind of know about these disciples and a little something about Jesus. And what was amazing to me, if you read the story, if you read the 21st chapter, it talks about the fact that before Jesus said this to Peter, they didn't even know it was Jesus at first. You know, they were out fishing, right? They were out doing what they do. They were out fishing. And they, you know, saw this person standing on the, you know, the banks of the river of the sea. And they were trying to fish. They hadn't caught any fish. And Jesus, at the time, they didn't know it was Jesus, told them to cast the net a certain way. And when they did, you know, the nets began to break because they had so many fish. So what was so amazing to me, so once again, given a little history about the chapter and a little history before we get to the verse that I just read. So what was happening was this. Think about this. The same situation Jesus met Peter in, he met him again. He came back and Peter was fishing again. Because think about this. Matthew 4:18-20 says this. And Jesus was walking by the Sea of Galilee. This is when Jesus first met Peter. He saw two brethren, Simon called Peter and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And he said unto them, follow me. I need y'all to catch that right there. He said, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. So he met them fishing, you know, trying to fish, trying to net. And he said those words to him in the very beginning when he met him. He said, follow me and I will make you fisher of men. Now think about this. They hadn't even met Jesus. But when he said that to them, they immediately, the scripture said they immediately followed him. Follow me and I will make you fishers of men. So now that's his first encounter with Peter. So as I begin to study this word, and it was amazing to me that the same life, and when I say life, I'm talking what he spoke. The same life he spoke to him when he chose him. Remember, he chose the disciples. The same life he spoke to him when he chose them was the same life he spoke again to him. He said again, follow me. So remember when we were studying the word and we began to say from the foundations of the world, Jesus knew us. In our mother's womb, he knew us, right? So the very first time he saw Peter and the very first thing what he said to Peter was, follow me. So you are chosen to be who Jesus Christ has chosen you to be from the very beginning. He said to Peter, I will make you fishers of men, right? So now at the end, after his death, after Peter done cut off the soldier's ear, after Peter done denied him, done lied, and said, not once, Peter lied three times.
three times.
But Jesus loved Peter.
Yes.
So he knew Peter. See, what's so amazing? See, God chose us, right? So he know me. So when men don't know me and they want to judge me a certain way, or they want to look at me twisted or crooked, Jesus chose me, right? He chose me. So the mistakes I made, he knew I was going to make them. But what he also knew, Peter said, if you read the chapter, he said, Jesus, you know I love you. You know I love you. So Jesus knows we love him, saints. He knows it. And remember I said last week, Peter got it right. You know, Peter was one of the disciples at the end who gave his life for Jesus. The same Peter who denied him after Peter got filled with the Holy Ghost. You know, as Gwen was talking about that comforter, that friend that God was going to send us. After Peter got filled with that, Peter, who God chose from the very beginning, who he told him from the very beginning, follow me. What has God told you about you from the very beginning?
Come on, girl.
What did God tell you when he first chose you? What did he say about you that he's still saying about you to this day? He said to Peter, follow me. I will make you fishers of men. So at the end, when he rose from the dead and presented himself to them three times, when he came back that third time, he said to Peter, follow me. Feed my sheep. And who was the sheep? It was the men, the same people that he said, I will make you fisher of men. Now he's calling them sheep. Feed my sheep. Do you love me? Follow me. So what was so amazing to me was that from the very beginning, God chose us. From the very beginning, he knew who he called us to be. From the very beginning, he knew there were times we would get it right, we would get it wrong. But he knew our hearts, just like he knows Peter's. And you know what? The amazing thing was, he didn't change what he said to Peter about Peter. He didn't change it. He said, follow me. He still told him what he said to him in the beginning when he chose him. So, do you love me? Follow me. Feed my sheep. Saints, it is so important that we know that we're chosen by God. It's so important that we know that God has chosen us. Because when we mess up, when others want to talk about us, when we, like Gwen said, we may not be denying God with our mouth, but maybe we're denying him in our actions. Maybe when we're around certain people, we don't want to let them know we really got stalkers.
Undercover.
But I need you to understand this, that you are who he's called you to be from the very beginning. You are who he's called you to be from your mother's womb. And he loves you. And he chases after you because you are important to him. So this particular scripture blessed me. It blessed me when I began to when the Lord began to say, I found Peter back where he was. See, because sometimes in this walk, you know, when we don't feel, when we mess up, we want to revert back to something we comfortable with. We want to revert back to our familiar, to some our comfort zone. So what did Peter do? Peter was out there fishing again, but God had a greater work for Peter because he chose him. So in the fact that we have a great work to do for God, proclaiming his gospel, you know, being owned by him and being now chosen by him to do his work, we can't, when we mess up, want to run back to our comfort zone. We now have to love him, follow him, feed his sheep. So saints, if you don't get nothing tonight, get this. You are who he chose you to be from the beginning. Everything he's called you to be, you are. Everything he said about you is true. Mm. Everything, Peter. Follow me in the beginning. Even after the mess ups, God still wanted Peter. He still wants you. Mm. He loves us so much. He knows us. He loves us. He's chosen us. So this is why it's important
that you know that you're called and that you're chosen. Thank God. Do you love me? Just like the word said that Jesus loved Peter, he loves us saints. We just got to walk this thing out and know that we are called to greatness. We are called to greatness.
Come on, girl.
Feed a sheep. You got a job to do because you're no more your own.
Yes.
We have a job to do.
And I love that because it just reminds me, you know, there was about 18 years in the first big church, first major church relationship that I had. And the pastors, I consider them to be my spiritual parents. And I learned about vision and the Holy Spirit and the Word of God and all of that from them. And when that relationship ended, I was crushed, like just crushed. It's the only word I can use. And I was church homeless. The Holy Spirit told me I was church homeless for 12 years.
Wow.
But in that 18 years, all I thought was about was being called of God, being chosen of God, that I felt like I had a purpose. I was helping to start ministries. I was, you know, pastor's assistant and the pastor's wife's assistant, and I was helping preach, and I was an associate, everything. But then when that ended, I was just destroyed. And I tried to join other churches, and it just never worked out. It just never felt the same, and I just wandered. And so to think that I am now a part of Rainfire, I have a church family that I love, I feel like I can invest myself in a place that's teaching the Word of God, that is really trying to go out and obey this great commission. And the fact that he's like, when you say that, Kim, it just reminds me, he's like, what I said about you has not changed. So all the things I believed during those 18 years, he didn't change his mind. Didn't matter how many years I was gone or I wasn't following hard after him. And he's like, all I need to know is, do you love me? After all that, let's come back to the bottom line. Do you love me?
Yeah.
All he needs you to say is yes. And then just follow him. That's it. That's what God's Talkers is about. We just need to follow hard after him, because there's nothing will satisfy outside of his purpose and call on your life. And you don't have to wait until you're worthy of the call. The Spirit of God makes you worthy. He's the one that helps you. He's the one that teaches you. He takes you by the hand and guides you and tells you what to say, tells you what to do. Your job is to follow. That's it. Because we love him.
Right.
That's it.
And just gotta know you're chosen. And that you're important to him.
Yeah.
You know, that is where, you know, that is really where it lies. I asked the question in chapter 15. I said, are you chosen? Do you know who you are? Because it comes a point where now, guys, we gotta know who we are in God. We got to know that we're chosen. We got to know that I'm not trying to be like someone else. I only want to be who God has chosen me to be. And it takes being thirsty after him. It takes understanding what eternal life is. And it takes this love walk that we've been talking about since we've been doing John. Because if you notice, it constantly comes back to that. He loves us, and he wants us to walk in our purpose.
Yep.
But it truly means, as that scripture said, knowing the true God and the true Jesus Christ, his son. And what it means for your life, I don't know. What it means for this one's life, I don't know. You have to know what it means for your life. What does it mean that you are chosen by God? What does it mean to Samantha? What does it mean to Shay? What does it mean to Ashley? Peyton, Valerie, Wyatt? What does that mean to your life? That at the end of the day, that's the question that we have to ask. What does it mean for your life? Based on what the Word of God says, what does it mean
that you are called and chosen. That you are now his. It's such an honor. The word of God says we're his possession. It's an honor to be God's possession. It's an honor for him to call us sons and daughters, that we can proclaim his gospel. We don't take it lightly. It's an honor. So now, God, how can I honor you because I'm yours? You know, Peyton said about sitting, talking to daddy, sitting in the chair. You know, most children don't want to disappoint their parents, right? Most of them don't. They don't want to, you know, be a disappointment. So now, what does it mean to me to be Jesus's daughter and Jesus Christ's daughter, God's daughter? What does it mean? I want to honor him. So now I need to understand my call. I need to understand in what ways has he chose me to proclaim his gospel, to love, to feed his sheep, to follow him. What way does that apply to my life? What way?
I love this song. Oh, he loves us.
Woo.
Amen.
Amen.
Woo. God is good.
Yeah, that was good. So you said, I am I'm a tree. And I was studying about something else about trees. And, you know, I used to think that a tree was strong as its roots got deeper. But the reality is the tree gets strong because of the wind. So it's the wind and the adversity and those things that are blowing against us that seem like they're so difficult. Those are the things that make our trunks grow deep and our roots go strong. And so that's just so powerful when I heard that lyric in the song. Because no matter what you've been through, you know, I was so hurt, but out of all of that, it just made me stronger, for real. So now, as I step into God's choice of me, then I get to see his glory triumph over every situation, that every adversity and everything that I thought was gonna kill me, you know, and take me out. So anyway, whew, enough of that. So I mentioned in the beginning, we are not going to meet because the next two Tuesdays are both holidays. So next Tuesday is Christmas Day, and then the week after that is New Year. So what we're going to do is we won't meet, and then when we come back, we may change days because we don't want to conflict with the Tuesday night Bible studies, because the other small groups will not be meeting out. This session will end at the end of December. So we will keep you posted. But while we're on these breaks, go ahead and continue to go and look at the replays of the videos. Go read the blog posts again. Share it with other people. I was telling Kim, it's been such a blessing that we've had people continuing to join God Stalkers, and we haven't been doing anything extra to try to get them. We have been promoting it all. We started out doing registrations on Eventbrite, and we left it there, even though we now have registration on the website. And so we get Eventbrite and website registrations every week. And this week we've had about three or four. It's just been amazing to see how it's growing. So continue to share with people. Go online, post comments on the blog, and just help us to spread the word. If you have your God Stalker, Faith Talker, Water Walker t-shirt, post pictures. Who is it? Christina and Aiden were wearing there, sent us a picture and said they was out representing in them streets. So remember, you can get the any of the products from the website. Anytime you purchase any of those, a portion of that is going to benefit Feed. And our vision and our hope and our prayer is that one day we're going to be able to finance all a feed through our efforts. And then my goal is to finish writing the Confessions of a God Stalker book before the year is out. So hopefully when we come back, you'll be able to get that. And we will just keep you posted. Yes, Jane, it was hilarious. So that's it. I'm gonna unmute us so we can say goodnight. Who's gonna pray us out first?
We gave wait. After all this time, they should be jumping at it. They know.
Hello, right? They should be fighting over it. Somebody said Peyton. Shay said Peyton. She getting volunteered. Look at Peyton's mouth. That's hilarious. Yes.
Who volunteered Peyton?
Shay. That's hilarious. Samantha. Shay's volunteering Samantha.
No, right. Why? Is she doing that? I'm pretty sure I did that before.
Okay.
You know what? My internet keeps doing something crazy. So it's kind of crazy. I don't even want to chance it this time.
Well, I'm tempted to call Ashley, but I don't want to scare her away.
I know.
Listen, I'm really sad that I could not get on and join you ladies for the other sessions that I missed. I'm so sad that it's the last one, but maybe I'll get a little.
Go back and listen to the videos.
I am, and yeah. I'm gonna recruit some people to maybe watch it with me. So that's
that'll be good.
And then you know maybe I'll get a little more when I get to Georgia.
Oh, when you come in?
Can't tell.
Ashley says. I leave my baby alone for the first time.
She said, I have kids that I don't scare easy.
So, would you like to pray us out, Ashley? I hear that. Shay say, leave my baby alone. It's her first time.
We're going to break her in 2019. Okay, we can do that.
All right, then, Ashley. We'll break you in.
I love it. Yeah.
Well, Ashley, thanks for joining us. We're definitely appreciative of having you here. Shay told us that you were a friend and a very dear friend to her, and that you were going to be joining us.
She's so related. Thanks, family.
Yeah. Thank you for joining us.
Okay, well, I'll pray us out. Amen. Father, we just thank you so much for this time. We thank you for thank you for your spirit. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your word. We thank you that we have an opportunity to come together to know more about you, to help each other, to lift each other up. And we just thank you that as we take this break, Father, we take the time just to dig in a little bit more, to come after you even harder, to not allow ourselves to be distracted by just the busyness of the season, but that you would help us, Father, just to reflect on everything that you wanted to be imparted to us during this time. We ask that you would just set us on fire. Help us to truly stalk you, to come after you hard, to love you more, to have a heart for you, a thirst for you, a hunger for you, for your word, that we would take it upon ourselves, Father, to read, that we would talk among ourselves about everything that you are teaching us, that we would give it away, that just as you have freely given to us, and that you would help us to just rise up and to be the chosen ones that you have ordained, that you would help us, Father, to have a holy, attitude about ourselves, that you would help us not to esteem ourselves highly in our own flesh and ability, but that you would help us to look at ourselves the way you see us, to understand that everything you've ordained, that it's possible for us now, that we don't have to wait, we don't have to put it off, we don't have to get ready, we just need to walk in what you've given and do it by faith, believing. And we just thank you for it. We thank you that all for all the people who have joined God Stalkers, for those who just listen by video for whatever reason, those in every state, Father, we've got them all over the country, and we just thank you and we praise you for it in the name of Jesus, and that you would give us fresh revelation, that you would help us, Father, as we come back after the break, and we just thank you for it in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Also, I just want to share what Wyatt did today. And he didn't even tell me he was doing it. I saw him writing with this paper, like the name, the contacts, and his phone. Well, he sent the guy stalker's link to every single contact in his phone today.
Come on now.
Over 90-some people. I believe he said it was 91 people. Because he wanted them to be able to share this gospel and share. So I just want to say that we appreciate you, Brother Wyatt.
Y'all for doing the same thing. Yes, we all need to do that. Thanks for going first, Wyatt.
Yes. And everyone have a safe holiday.
Yeah.
You know, have a beautiful Christmas holiday, a New Year's, you know, holiday. Just everybody.
So we say bye.
Everybody be safe.
Bye, everybody.
Merry Christmas, Happy New Year.
Merry Christmas, Happy New Year.
Appreciate you guys.
Merry Happy birthday, Kim.
Oh, yes, happy birthday. Happy birthday, Wyatt.
Yeah, a lot of December birthdays.
Yeah.
All right, bye.
Bye.